Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Christie's, and welcome to this historic moment in Christie's history, which is the launch of the collection of Peggy and David Rockefeller here in Hong Kong. We will be having a panel discussion this afternoon on art and philanthropy, two subjects very close to the Rockefeller family heart. And our panelists this afternoon are Peter Johnson, seated at the center, who is the Rockefeller family historian, who has worked for the Rockefellers for many years. We have Roger King, founder and director of the Denota Center for Asian Family Business and Entrepreneurship Studies. We have Alice Mong from Asia Society, an organization founded by the Rockefeller family. We have Mark Porter, who is my colleague and dear friend, who is the chairman of Christie's Americas. And our moderator is Marissa Fung Shaw, who I will be very happy to hand over to now.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. We already actually started to discuss quite a few things in the lounge when we all met. And I think there's a very, very strong Rockefeller collection here that we discovered that came to sort of seep through our conversations. I think we're drawn here because really, if we're looking at the arts and the Rockefeller family, one of the quotes that came up in some of the reading that I looked at is that true respect for art dramatically enhances respect for the cultures that created it. And here we find a really amazing, amazing is too simple a word to put to the collection, but just quite a wealth of a collection that had a fantastic narrative that Christie's has put together that has brought us here today. I'd like to start with Peter Johnson, who is the Rockefeller family historian, who will be a repository of information for us. We'll start by introducing the Rockefeller family in context for those of you who are not as familiar. Would you like to begin?
Thank you, Marissa. It is wonderful to be here. Hong Kong is such a beautiful place. I've been here 3 or 4 times, and I love coming back. It's really wonderful. And it's great to be here with the people from Christie's and accompanying some of David Rockefeller's wonderful pieces of art, which are going to become available next year. It struck me this morning that probably people have heard the name John D. Rockefeller, but don't know very much about him. So what I want to do is to just quickly give you a couple of facts which might help in the context of the discussion we're going to have here. John D. Rockefeller was an American business genius of the mid-19th century. He's similar, to try to bring it up to date, somebody like Bill Gates, or Jeff Bezos, or Steve Jobs, or possibly even Jack Ma in China. He was able to create a totally new business that had never existed before. The name of that business was the Standard Oil Corporation, and it became the dominant, not quite a monopoly, there was still 10% that was left to others. But it was, in fact, the dominant, at least American oil company, and probably the world, dominated the world as well for a long period of time. Needless to say, that created a great deal of wealth for John D. Rockefeller. He was also probably, at one point in time, the most hated and feared person in the United States. Wealth of that magnitude had never quite occurred before. So people were very wary and afraid of these new concentrations of wealth, the largest of which was John D. Rockefeller's. At the same time that he was building this massive and impressive corporation that, that modernized the American petroleum industry, he was also a man of very simple tastes, a very religious fellow. He was a Baptist, and he felt that charitable work was not only a nice thing to do, but absolutely incumbent upon him as a Christian to do it. And he was always quite generous during his younger years, 5 cents here, 10 cents there. One of his first contributions was, in fact, to a Chinese missionary society for 5 cents in 1863. The really important thing, however, about his charitable activities was the fact that he was convinced that with this vast wealth, he might be able to do even more impressive things than simply give away little bits of money each year. And that conviction led to what we know now as the great Rockefeller philanthropies, the Rockefeller Foundation, the Rockefeller University, and a number of other things that sought to fundamentally transform society by attacking things like disease and poverty in a systematic and scientific way. And it's really that philanthropic tradition that we're talking to you about today. And it's that philanthropic tradition that was handed on from John D. Rockefeller to his son, John D. Rockefeller Jr., who, among other things, helped to create the Peking Union Medical College and get the public health system of China at least to a point where it could begin to do something. John D. Rockefeller Jr. passed that same philanthropic tradition on to his 5 sons and 1 daughter, one of whom was David Rockefeller. And so this tradition exists, it continues into the future, it has had a major impact on the world. I'm very proud to say I've worked for the family for 40 years. It's an amazing family. These accomplishments are really quite important. One further thing. The engagement with Asia is particularly important in understanding Rockefeller philanthropy. In the video that you saw, references made to the 1921 trip that John D. Rockefeller Jr. and Abby made to China and Japan for the opening of Peking Union. I think there's an even more important trip that was undertaken in 1929 by John D. Rockefeller III, the oldest of the sons. After graduating from Princeton, he took a round-the-world trip, and among the places that he stopped and spent quite a great deal of time in was China and then Japan. The China he saw in 1929 was dramatically different from the China that his father and mother had seen only 8 years earlier. By 1929, Chiang Kai-shek and the Kuomintang had driven out the communists, suppressed the communist faction within it. Chiang Kai-shek had undertaken the Northern Expedition. The Japanese were moving aggressively into Manchuria and North China. What John Rockefeller saw was the China that would go through the throes of the continuing revolution and process of modernization for the rest of the century. And those are the things that John D. Rockefeller III, David Rockefeller, Nelson Rockefeller, and the Rockefeller institutions would wrestle with for the rest of the century and into this one. So this is China is a very significant element. It helped to, I guess you would say Rockefeller philanthropy helped to form China, but itself was fundamentally transformed by China itself. So hopefully that'll give you a bit of context for what will follow.
And I think following Peter's point, the philanthropic mindset that was actually handed down by John D. Rockefeller Sr., there were several overarching themes that you could actually see, and perhaps you might also see this in the way Peggy and David collected. They, in the philanthropic approach, they always relied on the wisdom of others and when conceptualizing their philanthropy, and they wanted to convene the best minds to study issues before they went to help people. it wasn't a top-down initiative where they thought this was something that they might have decreed as the correct approach. So this was very, very important to convene the wisdom of other people. And they also very much believed in sharing of the work by encouraging and enticing others. Conditional gifts, matching gifts, these were sort of initiatives that they actually started. They actually wanted to bring other people in to do similar work together with them. And I think, again, drawing back into today's context here, one way that their art is going to reach the world is now through this auction and the proceeds of these auctions reaching the charities, and for people here to actually also enjoy the artwork that they have done over the years. And the final part to this framework is responsible stewardship. They've always been very involved in the philanthropy that they do. They believe that with great wealth comes a duty to serve the public good and improve conditions of mankind, which Peter had just described. So if we could also maybe discuss a little bit about David and Peggy and how they fit into the family dynamics.
Yeah. David was the youngest child, sixth child, and youngest son of John D. Rockefeller Jr. and Abby Aldrich Rockefeller. He married Peggy Rockefeller in September of 1940. They were married very happily for 55 years. Younger sons, I think, always have a slightly more difficult road to travel than their older siblings. And I think that was somewhat the case with David. Most of the other positions, so to speak, had already been taken by the time David became an adult. But he sort of inherited responsibility for the Rockefeller University. He proved, because of his, I think, his personality and the way he looked at the world, a pretty good ambassador of the Rockefeller philanthropy. What Marissa has just said about sort of assembling the best minds to kind of talk about different ideas is something that both David and Peggy would do. The Trilateral Commission is a good example of David trying to bring together lots of different representatives of countries in both the Asia-Pacific region and Europe to discuss problems and try to work through them. Peggy and David spent an enormous amount of their time during the course of their marriage traveling to different parts of the world in order to carry out these kinds of conferences and meetings. One of David's old associates, Bill Flans, is here, and he did a lot of the traveling. When David was the chairman of the Chase Manhattan Bank, he was really criticized for the amount of foreign travel he was doing. Why isn't he staying home and making sure the checkbook balances and that kind of thing? What people didn't understand was he believed very deeply that Americans belonged in the world, and you had to create institutions that linked America to the world. In some ways, the first of the institutions that he did that with was the Chase Manhattan Bank, which is now J.P. Morgan Chase. It was internationalized. It became the first, along with Citibank, the first great American banks. So this is sort of the operationalization of the Rockefeller tradition in the business world. They didn't stop making money when they retired from Standard Oil. The Rockefellers continue to invest in the world. Lawrence Rockefeller, one of David's brothers, was one of the great venture capitalists. He was one of those people that underwrote Apple and Intel and so on and so forth. Rockefellers always believed that the making of the money and the dispensing of the money through philanthropy were sides of the same coin. And I'm not sure what else to say there.
Well, we are segueing into the arts and philanthropy in the sense that here with Christie's, Why do you think it's appropriate for this collection to start its journey in Asia? And what is the history of Christie's and the various Rockefeller family members?
Well, it's appropriate to start here in part because of the deep family connection to Asia, both in terms of its business and its culture. There's such a deeply respectful and foundational element to Asia in the way that the Rockefellers approach business and approach how they bought. From a purely commercial perspective, it makes sense to launch this collection here because about one third of our buyers are now from Asia, Hong Kong and the mainland in the majority, but all through Asia. Japan, Singapore, Indonesia, Korea, Taipei. And we are very conscious of bringing to this collecting community the best of what we have. So launching the greatest collection of works of art that Christie's has ever handled in Asia, at the center of the Asian art market, seemed right for this particular collection.
And I believe that Dave was very mesmerized by his first encounter with Asian art when he was about 6 years old. I think it was in 1921, when his parents brought back a whole treasure trove from their travels. And I think this is one way that, as a child, he'd come across beauty. This is his first contact with something that he had never seen before. And I think immediately he was quite intrigued about the mysteries of the cultures that actually created this artwork. So in a very sort of a nice way, this collection starting to be launched from here is a very nice beginning to the narrative again of the collection. Alice, as executive director of the Asian Society, which was started by John D. Rockefeller III, could you discuss a little bit more about their legacy in Asia, the Rockefeller family, and perhaps how Asian philanthropy, through your contact, has developed?
Thank you, Marissa. I'm delighted to be here talking about the organization that I work for and the Rockefellers. I had the honor this summer of visiting the archive as a field trip. The director of the Asia Society, we gather once a year back in New York, and several times in Pocantico, but this time it was at West Point, and we had a field trip to the archive. And I found the founding paper, board paper of Asia Society, which was established in 1956 by John D. Rockefeller III, which would be David's oldest brother.
Yeah.
And Asia Society was founded very much to connect, you know, broader, the deeper understanding at the time in 56 about of Americans about Asia. Think about it, 1956, understanding, you know, Korea conflict. We're still living with the ramification of that conflict today. And Vietnam had not happened yet. And 56 was a very formative year. And I think what Peter said about the family's connection and love in China and Asia is very much the genesis of Asia Society in 56. And then fast forward, Asia Society Hong Kong was established in 1990, and so it's very apropos that the first first center outside of the US is here in Hong Kong in 1990. So in terms of the philanthropy, Asia Society really is using the arts and that John D. Rockefeller III and his wife collected from their 1929 trips onward, and even before, I believe, the family collection of Asian art to start Asia Society Museum and Asia Society in New York. And so here in Hong Kong, we've had the pleasure of mounting, I think, our first exhibition here in Hong Kong when we opened our new home in 2012 was the Buddhism and Art, the Rockefeller collection. And so this is where, in some ways, we're delighted to see, and I'm really personally looking forward to seeing the collection And this is where Hong Kong kind of plays this role. And philanthropy, I think, is very important for the founding of Asia society, not only in New York, but here in Hong Kong. Without the kind of the philanthropic philanthropy, the culture that the Rockefeller brought to it, we would not have this wonderful center, which is here in Admiralty, that we can bring arts and cultural programming, deepening the understanding of Asia today. And so this is, last year we celebrated the 60th anniversary of Asia Society, and now we have 12 centers around the world to really introduce Asia, not only through the arts. I think arts is a really easy way to talk about soft power. You don't have to understand the language, but arts is very visual, so I think it's very apropos that we're here to celebrate the collection, and we're very honored that Asia Society Hong Kong here is part of this, the philanthropic giving of the Rockefeller family.
So I myself am also part of another organization that has benefited from the Rockefeller legacy, and that's the Asian Cultural Council, which supports artists, individual artists, on grants and experiences for research in the U.S. as well as in other Asian countries. So this piece about sort of dialogue and people meeting each other and collections visiting in the arts context different countries really has played a huge role in connecting people and enabling to understand each other better. I think David, in his memoirs, had also said that it's not only is it important to make these connections, but the face-to-face discussions and contacts, and hence their travels, have really enhanced the understanding of people for their different cultures, the economics, and the various issues that everyone commonly faces.
Yes.
So this brings me to Roger, who we've also known for a very long time, and his family has been very involved in the arts, and he himself has been dealing as a founder and director of the Tanto Center for Asian Philanthropy, a family business, and not only in the arts but also in understanding Asian families and the development of their businesses. And we were discussing just now about how we would describe the Asian approach to philanthropy and the Western approach to philanthropy, and how that's actually starting to present itself today.
Well, thank you, Marissa. It's a great honor to be here. And whilst we're outside just chatting a little bit, it just occurred to me, we do have another connection to the Rockefeller family itself. Because my wife, Alyssa, her first job, after she graduated from university in library science, was working for the Rockefeller Library in Rockefeller Center itself. So it just occurred to me whilst we were chatting a little bit. I didn't think of it until just now. So it's a small world indeed. And of course, I've known Marissa's family for a long, long time. Marissa's mother is, I think, a godmother to my daughter, and so, so it's a small world indeed. As far as, philanthropy is concerned with the ethnic Chinese families, so forth, Chinese have always been very, very giving, want to give back to the society, and so forth and so on. The usual forms of gifts is usually back to their home village itself, and it's usually to educational institution. In fact, we recently, under my research hat on the family businesses, we did a comparative study of overseas Chinese to Jewish diasporas. And both culture, in terms of similarity, they value education a great deal. And also philanthropic endeavor, it's usually back to some university. And whilst I was in Tel Aviv University recently, all the buildings in Tel Aviv University are named, and also all the large halls are named. So I was there for a while, and then I said, by the way, where is the men's room? They said, oh, that way. I said, is the men's room named as well. But the fact is that both the Jewish culture as well as the ethnic Chinese culture is very, very giving. But one of the things that, you know, talk about art and philanthropy, here in our Chinese, serious Chinese collector, and I learned something new, Mark was saying a third of the your current clients are primarily Asians itself. You know, for a long, long time, the first half of the 20th century, you know, the Chinese are really, you know, whether you're mainland or elsewhere, you're basically nomads, you know. We have this sojourney mentality. In fact, it used to be when you see another Chinese overseas, it's always the first conversation is, where are you from? Meaning, what is your home village itself? So, you know, the idea of collecting things that are less movable is very, very difficult. And it's only the second half of the 20th century where the wealth is accumulated and people are a little bit more stable. So the idea of, you know, linking art to philanthropy is relatively new conceptually. This is an interesting thing. But I might share a little bit of my own situation. I mentioned
yes.
to my wife is she collects basically contemporary Chinese art, mostly in ink. She actually has a very, very successful gallery here in town, which now has been taken over by on a day-to-day basis by my daughter. In fact, she's supposed to be sitting here, not me. Okay, and I'm an avid collector of 14th century porcelain, so we don't have to conflict itself. And so at this age, we've been sort of thinking, what should we do with our collection in the future? So there are basically three options. One is to sell it. One is to split it amongst, I have three children, split it amongst them. And the third is to keep it together. You know, so those are the three options one has. And so I thought about it, maybe we should actually split it, okay? And it was very, very fortunate, thanks to Christie's, they actually did a appraisal of our collection itself, and primarily for insurance purposes. But what it does is also puts some framework about how much these things are worth. So I thought about, and I told my children, all three of them, they have two sons and one daughter, I'm very, very fair, you know, everyone gets the same share, so each will get a third. And the idea is the, whatever the appraised value is, that's the pool of money, virtual money, okay? And the idea is that each will get a third of the virtual money itself. And so then we'll take every piece of art, and whoever likes it, they can take it, deduct it from their portion of the virtual money itself. If nobody wants it, we'll put it up for sale. I'll explain that a little bit later on also. If two of them or more want the same piece, whether it's porcelain or works of art, then we create an internal auction. and they use that money from the pool, the virtual money, and they'll reduce the amount accordingly itself.
Well, Christie's be?
Well, sort of internal Christie's. this is one way. And one of the reasons why I says sell it instead of giving it to, well, there are two reasons. If we sell it, one of the problems I see is giving to a museum. Very often, it gets put away in a storage area and never gets seen light of day again, very, very often. And that's not very, very good. But if you sell it, you know, the next person who acquires it will have a passion for that and they'll perpetuate that. So this is what I intend to do with the, so the proceeds, you know, we, our family, we have a separate foundation and everything else. So I segregate art from the, you know, philanthropic side, and they can put it back in. And in fact, we're thinking of doing something specifically for my wife because of her love for ink art, and we're thinking of establishing an ink museum on her behalf, actually. So this is the way we see it. And so I think the idea of philanthropy and art, somehow we will probably link it at a much further down the line than today. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So Mark, building on Roger's thoughts here, do you see a trend in philanthropists leveraging on their art, or art collectors leveraging?
Yeah. I think in the case of David and Peggy Rockefeller, and keeping in mind that David's mother was the founder of the Museum of Modern Art with two other women, they were, and back to Peter's point of always having the best experts or getting expert advice about everything they did and seeking that. The Rockefellers followed the advice of a great director and scholar named Alfred Barr, who was the director of the Museum of Modern Art and is known for having put together the most extraordinary collection of modern art in the world. And he also advised Peggy and David in their collecting as well. And as they collected with an eye to filling the places in the museum's collection that might be empty in terms of very important works of art. So works at the highest level designated not to be in storage, but to fill out particular works, to fill out particular areas that were missing things. And then at the same level of collecting, superb works of art for David and Peggy's collection, ultimately to be sold for philanthropic purposes, which is what you see today. So one of the reasons that there are works of such rarity is that they followed the advice of one of the world's greatest curators and directors ever. In the contemporary world of art buying and art collecting, many of you may have come across the phenomena that artists working together with their dealers may require a collector to buy a work of art for placement in a museum at the same time that they release a work of art to that person's private collection, so that the cultivation and direction of an artist's career goes hand in hand with endowing museums with important works of art. That's something that we see, that's a development in art collecting and in art dealing that we've seen over the past 10 or 15 years.
So you actually see either the artworks or the funds actually coming into building capacity in the arts, mm-hmm. and arts institutions as well. And what about Christie's role in this dynamic of philanthropy in the arts?
Well, one of the things that we find is that because of the amount of attention played in the world right now to works of art and sales of works of art, it becomes an opportune time to tell about the philanthropic interests that are funded by those sales or that the family or the collector also cares about. So you'll see that a lot of the materials that we've produced and a lot of the communication that we have about this sale is also about the foundations and the causes that the Rockefeller family cares about. So the Rockefeller University in particular, the home of so many Nobel Prize winners working in pure science and making discoveries that impact us every day. Harvard University, some other educational institutions that you may know about, but also funding the family's great interest in this generation, which is environmental and conservation issues. And then of course, having passed on, as Peter talked about, an interest in health and the health of communities to new philanthropists like the Gateses, who are picking up at yet another level and moving that forward. So what we can do is be part of that thread of teaching people about philanthropy and using works of art sometimes to do that.
Can I add to that? I think what Mark said was really interesting too, is that historically, I think the Rockefeller in terms of philanthropy and building these institutions. And I think one of the things I wanted to mention is really the Magsaysay Prize that was really established by the Rockefeller Brothers Fund, in the 50s. And it's kind of the Asia's equivalent of the kind of Nobel Prize. And that I was reminded by our Asia Society Philippine chair, Doris Ho, about the Magsaysay Prize. So in some ways, this is kind of furthering that journey, kind of exhibition, the sales, because traditionally the family, Asia has been very important to them, but also promoting artists. We've done several exhibitions as well as honoring certain Asian artists, and in their biography, I often read that they were the recipient of the Rockefeller Fellowship, Arts Fellowship. I think Ho Ching Fan, Wu Shi Wang, there's so many of them who benefited from I think in whether it's 50s or 60s. So this is really kind of the furthering of these of the arts philanthropy journey.
So I think we sort of see a slight convergence with the approach to their philanthropic process. The art collecting, it was a pleasure. It's both a pleasure to do philanthropy as well as collect the arts. And it's through their collecting that they started to learn more and more about the culture. But they also had an appreciation of beauty. And this collection allowed them to dialogue with artists, with other business people, in fact. But I think they also had a sense that they were stewards. It's temporary, the enjoyment. So what we're seeing now is, having been stewards, and I think they wrote this somewhere, that it is a gift, this collection now is a gift to give back to the world again, so that other people can enjoy the different pieces. And the proceeds from the sale will benefit charities that they have very carefully selected. Can you tell us a little bit about how they might have selected some of these charities, or what their thinking might be?
Yeah. Well, there are 12 separate institutions that will benefit from not just the sale of the art collection, but also the sale of other assets in Mr. Rockefeller's personal estate. Some of these are institutions that there's a very long family history with. The Rockefeller University was established in 1901. And Rockefellers have been involved with it for well over 100 years. Council on Foreign Relations is another, and Rockefellers were involved with the creation of that in the early 1920s. Harvard, of course, what do you say about Harvard? It's been around a long time. It's got a very large endowment already. Some of the others are smaller and younger. The Maine Coast Heritage Trust was established by Peggy Rockefeller in the 1970s to sort of do something about inappropriate development along the Maine Coast. There's so many parts of the world where beautiful places are being marred by overbuilding or even building itself. So this is an effort to do something in one specific part of the world. The Stone Barn Center for Food and Agriculture, which was established by David and his daughter Peggy in honor of Peggy the wife, is an effort to foster thinking about and work in sustainable and resilient agriculture. And it has only been in existence for about 15 years. But it's been mimicked in a lot of other places. This is a very important issue: local, sustainable, resilient agriculture in a world where we need to feed 7 billion people. We have to do something about monoculture and so on. So these are all the traditional categories of conservation, environment, this, that, and the other thing. They begin to overlap. So agriculture and the environment come together in ways that they didn't before. You need to practice good environmental stewardship in order to make sure that agriculture is done properly and we continue to have enough land to grow food on in the future. So all of these things
fit together in very, very significant ways.
So the philanthropy, philanthropic approach has really been a very, very thoughtful process, and something that has been ingrained in the family culture. I had the opportunity to actually chat with David Rockefeller Jr. because actually my father, who was a roommate, this is another another story underneath, was a roommate of David Rockefeller Jr. at Harvard University, and hence my involvement with the Asian Cultural Council, and I'm finding myself here. And David was here to continue some of the philanthropic work that they're doing with their foundation. And I said, you know, you've lived with all these different pieces growing up, and all these pieces are now going to be sold. How do you feel about it? I mean, I might feel a little bit strange. And he actually said to me, he felt very invigorated and very energized. He says, we've enjoyed it. Obviously, there might be one or two things that we've kept, and, you know, we've chosen the pieces. But I'm really energized by the prospect that this collection is now going to be spread out across the world so that other people can enjoy. And we are actually going to help these charities that my parents have selected. And I said, and the other thing, I said, well, is there anything that you would want to convey to, you know, the people that we're speaking to? And he says his parents really appreciated beauty. And I also recall in David's memoirs that he said, you know, beauty is something that you can't quite describe. It's very subjective. And one of the moments that he described was when they had heard about Pearl Harbor. And I think they were just going to see the Frick collection. And he stood in front of the Vermeer. And they were in shock. The world was in turmoil. Everything was upside down. And standing in front of this painting, this Vermeer painting, he found a moment of solace, of calm, where everything was very, very still. And so I think probably my interpretation, and I can't put words in it, would be, and also from my experience, is that you do. You draw this subjective landscape of calmness and beauty and internalize it. And you're seeing this in the personality of the collection. And his parents said they would always select the pieces together, or if one saw it, the other was brought in to discuss, and they did not buy a piece if they didn't agree. And then they would also think about where they would place it in their house or in their various properties. So the entire process of collection was very personal to them. Even though they did have people advising them, it was very much a joint effort, and it was a journey together of love and appreciation of beauty. So I think this is something that he also, you know, I'm a messenger, you know, and I wanted to convey to you as well.
Yeah. I thought, you know, the word stewardship is very, very important itself. You know, in this room, I'm sure there many of you are collectors, otherwise you wouldn't necessarily be here. But you're really a steward, you know, of art. You really don't own it. You own it for a period of time that's it's stewardship. And it's really to be passed on to future generations, whether it's within your own family or other families itself. So you better treat whatever you collect nicely, because you have a great responsibility to future generations of other people, you know, whether you are just a steward, okay, of art.
So I think we have some time now for questions. And I think there are mics at the back. If anybody has, and in the front. So if anybody has any questions, please feel free, raise your hand for a mic. Or thoughts, reflections, pledges of new artwork to Christie so that
No? And if not, I would actually like to thank the panel enormously for your insight this afternoon. And I'd like to invite you all to come and see the quite extraordinary works of art from the Peggy and David Rockefeller collection, which will be sold to benefit everybody. Thank you.
Thank you.